5:36, and the phone meeting is ordered. And we have a lot of stuff to talk about tonight, but I thought we could start with something just a little bit different. Take a few minutes and talk about anything that we are doing with the library that we're enjoying, a book that we're reading, a movie that we rented off the canopy, or a program that we just went to. If anyone would like to share anything.
Just read my book. I've just read my book, which I'm with the book club.
Yeah.
And it was good, and it was great, and it was available.
What's it called? Remarkably.
Remarkably Bright Features. Did you read it? Yeah. It's good. What is it? Remarkably Bright Features.
And what book club is this for?
This is for my book club that's been going for like 20 years.
Oh,
my
okay.
Old neighborhood.
All right.
So we're still meeting up.
That's great. Anybody else? I'm reading a book right now called The Door of No Return by Kwame Alexander, which is very interesting. It's a novel written more like a poem. Have you read it? It's very quick reading, but it's very interesting. Now you're always reading like 6 books at a time.
I have 2 other books and 3 other books going.
Wow, wait, how do you keep track of them all?
Because I need something to like decompress at the end of a school day. I find reading to be an emotional situation, just like when someone comes in to borrow a book, you don't ask them what book you're looking for, it's more like, what kind of state of mind are you in?
Sometimes I'm reading a book and then I'm like, I'm not even reading that
right.
So I'll read another one. I have 4 on the go at any one point. And then I'm listening to books as well in the car. So, you know, so Wareham Library really is very great value.
Yeah.
That's how I go to sleep at night. I do my audio books and I set them on timers.
Yeah.
So that way
right.
I do fall asleep, I don't miss out on a great deal of anything.
You go back then and catch up? Or
yeah, I go back and catch up.
I find that lasts me 1 minute into my timer.
I do 15 to 30 minute timer on the night.
1 minute and then I have to go back to 14 minutes on the night.
That's okay.
I also just finished our mystery book club.
Oh, good.
Book.
Like Echo?
Yes, yeah.
Echo, that sounds familiar. Who is that?
Michael
Connelly.
Oh, yes, my favorite. See,
is this, I think it's the first of the series.
Is it?
Yeah,
okay.
Yes.
I wondered about that.
So I was listening to his latest,
it was very interesting. It took me a while to get into it. I think because I really needed to be able to focus because there was so much detail and I was having a hard time doing that. Once I did, it was great.
And I will tell you that because the book club's here, found a couple of authors that I would not have read others.
Yeah, me too.
Now, at the end of their series, they have like 19 books, and I'm just in their
mind. Right. What is he going to do? Right.
Yeah.
I'm just waiting for her to
know. Yeah, that's one of the things I love about the Mystery Book Club. I've been reading lots of books, and I just wouldn't have chosen otherwise.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Everyone who should listen to a great audiobook, consider anything in the Walter Longmire series. Johnson.
Yes.
Because George Goodall does the reading, he has captured the characters.
So well. Yeah, it's a great series. I love that.
Well, thank you all for sharing that. I went to use the next starter, so you haven't missed much. We have 20 minutes from the last meeting. I think everybody knows that Larissa had her baby just the other day. What you probably don't know is that at 3 o'clock in the morning, the morning that she had the baby, she emailed me her notes from the January meeting.
That's amazing.
And said, I have to go to the hospital now. Here are the notes, correct, so, yeah. I had been telling her, just send me the notes whenever and I'll do them, because she was doing a lot getting ready for this child to be born, and, but she kept saying, no, I'm going to do it. And then the time got away from her.
So can I ask a quick question that maybe this will come up later in the meeting? Is she technically still a trustee?
Yes.
Correct.
Yeah.
But is it good?
Yeah, no, she's just taking a step back.
Doing a head count.
Yeah.
Which is causing her to explain the absence.
Right, exactly.
So I have a technical question for you, is she a clerk?
Yes, she is.
Then you need to make a clerk pro temp.
Yes, we did that.
Oh, we need to do it every year.
Yeah. Right, now we talked about it before we started, yes. So we need to vote, we need to move, okay, so somebody could move for Sarah to be the clerk pro temp. One second, anybody? All in favor, raise your hand. No opposed, okay. Sarah has graciously volunteered to be the secretary for the time that Rosa is out. But we will make sure to do that every time.
Every time.
Yes. Okay, all right, so announcements. You probably read in Patrick's report, but I was going to tell you about this also. On March 1st is the legislative breakfast in Westport. So I think I sent it out to everybody. Both my niece and I are thinking about going, and if anybody else wants to go, we can carpool together. I forget the exact time, but it's early, and March 1st is a day of the week, a Friday. Yeah, a Friday. Has anybody thought about whether they're interested in going?
I have thought about it, but that date's not good for me.
Okay, all right. Well, if you are, just let me know, and Margie and I will figure out getting there. Okay. All right. Also, I just sent you all an email that I got this afternoon about the revised code of conduct that came out in September. You need to review it, and it gives you instructions in there about signing the acknowledgement paper and returning it to Karen Wilbur in the select board's office. Okay. Any other?
Wait, I have a question about
this. Yes.
Is this separate and in addition to the ethics policy?
Yes, it is, which I had also sent to everybody right before or right after the last meeting. So if you haven't done that yet, then send
it. Ethics policy and.
And the ethics policy, which is ethics and conflict of interest together, and then the revised code of conduct. You should all have, and make sure that you get back to Karen Hogan in the select board office.
And also, the ethics is an annual requirement by the state.
And the code of conduct that was revised?
It was written in January. We had one January a year ago.
Okay.
And we had to change one word in it, so you should have gotten it back in September.
Okay. And also, I should just welcome to Judith Whiteside from the select board and to Mel Dyer, former trustee and now the library employee. Thank you for both of you for joining us. And Rich Wolverton, who we'll be talking about soon, because it applied to me, the trustee. So, other announcements. Sarah, do you have any announcements?
Yes, I do have an announcement.
Okay.
I'm running for the select board. It's a 2-year seat on the select board. So, this is why I was asking about headcount, because if I win, there's obviously no guarantee, but if I win, I cannot serve as a board member. So, we just need to be aware of that looking forward to next year, before the end of this fiscal year, I guess I might not be here. So, May 5th.
Yes.
And so we need to be aware of that and to
Maybe there's the election, and then would she actually take office?
The next day when she gets sworn in.
Yeah, yeah. So I actually have been, you know, I said before, ABC always be closing on Board of Library Trustee members, and so I've actually talked to four people lately about being a trustee, so hopefully, you know, some momentum will start happening if we also spread the word that new members are always welcome, because as you guys all know, can have seven. So five is a nice number, which is what we have currently, right?
No, we have six now.
There's six.
But with Larissa not being here, it takes it back to five. If we act on Rich's application, that will take us up to seven, but really only six at the meetings for the next few months.
So that's my answer.
Anybody else have any announcements?
Yes, can I just say that the Employee Appreciation Day was fabulous, except that I failed miserably because I made a new sci-fi, and I, last time I watched Star Wars was 100 years ago, so I wouldn't have known half the people.
I think there was one person from Star Wars.
There were a couple. I had no idea who they were.
Yeah.
No idea. Yeah. But it was fun. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. All right, so reports. Friends and Foundation.
Well, the Friends meeting was at 4 o'clock today. Yeah. Since yesterday, we didn't meet. The book cart opens on March 1st, and we will have our first book sale of the year in March.
I'm still always surprised how many people are posting on Facebook, where can I donate these books?
Okay, we're celebrating the ducks for the duck race, which I think we made. They showed it in cookie containers already for the cookies next year. We talked about something I think connected to the agenda item we have. Still talked about getting the banner made, maybe thinking about that. And check out making up a poster with the end names and applies for events. We may change one or two times of our winter meetings at someone's request. They go from 4 to 3:30 in a couple of months. We're thinking November and January.
Wait, I'm sorry, run that time again?
Someone requested we meet earlier than...
Oh, I see. Okay. We said 4 to 3:30. I was thinking we have to travel back in time?
Mm-hmm.
No. So starting at 3:30.
Yep.
Okay. I would agree with that. I know, I like that idea. Just, I'm a friend, I wasn't there, but I think it's a good idea to start earlier so you get out of there.
The only thing that bothers me is that, I mean, we meet at 5:30 and the foundation meets at 7. So people are working, like, when?
You're right, it's important.
Yeah. And the, it's kind of a, you know, 4 o'clock with the friends. The limits people might be interested in can't come. That's my only feeling about it.
Yeah, that's a very good point.
$20,000 for the rest of this year through June 30th?
This is America.
Okay, so does that mean that they did $40,000 then for the whole year?
Just $20,000 for the whole year.
Well, from July 1st to...
No, they gave $30,000 back in last March or April.
Okay. And that was for, from then until now?
Yeah.
They set a price of $25 for tickets for the comedy night. They gave the grant out of silent auction and live auction, and they allocated $5,000 for gala. And that's what's required.
Is there more about the gala that you want to talk about? Do you want to do that now since we're on that?
Sure.
Do you want to put it on the agenda a little bit later for next, since we're talking about that?
I was at the last planning committee meeting. I was kind of assuming that you have more information than I would, because there's so much time that's gone on since then to now, and there may be stuff going on behind the scenes. I know there's stuff going on behind the scenes that sort of has moved my information into the past a little bit, if that makes sense. So really, in my mind, from what we've been doing at the meeting is they did decide on a caterer. That's the $5,000. And of course, I can't think of his name, but it sounded really good. The two women that are on that committee are Sandra Wheeler and Susan Melrose. And they had done a lot of talking and a lot of going around town talking to various caterers and getting pricing and menu items and all that. And when they came, they had a pretty good, complete plan of food and drink and cutlery and everything included. And then there was the music subcommittee, I think it was the same two people, and they're, we're going to have Jeff Dunn, who goes by the name of Dunn and Dunn, I guess, with his brother, and they did an event at the Council on Aging, and it was extremely well received. So there's that. And then there was some subcommittee working on sort of marketing and graphics and stuff like that, and I don't know, at this moment in time, I don't know where that is. I know these subcommittees do a lot of work in between gala meetings, so that's why I feel like my information is rather old, so that I'm sure there's been things done in between our next meetings, the 27th, and I'm not proving that, I'm not on any of those emails. So those are the two things that I can remember for sure, that, and the venue is set. It's going to be at the boathouse, the onset.
They have talked about a goal for their fundraising, like how much they want to raise, or what they, or have they set any specific kinds of things that they are raising the money for? You know, like, you know, something in particular for the library, or they talk about things of that at all?
They didn't at the meeting, but that's not to say they don't necessarily know. I just feel like, again, it was so long ago that they met, and there was a lot of people leaving, a lot of people that were that meeting that are gone on vacation now, so it's just this moving part constantly moving forward. So those are the things I know for sure that I want to know.
And from the library's perspective, I think an unrestricted funding coming in might be better, because then it can be used whenever it's needed. But from the perspective of people who are actually giving donations, they may be more inclined to give donations when they know it's going towards specific kinds of programming or specific facility needs for the library. I think it would be good for them to figure that out.
Oh, I'm and also glad that they have it. I just need to apply that. I don't know.
Yeah, no, okay. Right. And but
believe me, I know there's a lot of stuff going on off my plate that I have no idea about. That's why I didn't want to sort of definitively say yes or no.
But it would be good for us to know, too, so that we can be talking about it to people and letting them know what's going on. Certainly, if people ask us, we should have a good idea of what it is. But I also just think that generally, when you're fundraising, it is important to have a goal that you're working towards. So it'd be good to that's a good goal.
I don't know, and there is, like, I'm not really sure.
How are they gonna make money on $25 a person, that's nice.
No, that's the comedy night.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay, we're talking about two different things.
Yes.
Yes, one's a fundraiser today, one's the gala in June.
The gala in June,
Is that the McFadden Center too?
That is, that is, the fundraiser comedy nights at Stohat Mall, yeah.
Okay.
And I think the gala in June is.
So that's where the $5,000 is.
That, yes.
Correct, that's where it caters.
There's a comedy fundraiser that is happening at Stohat Mall, and, the catering for that is being underwritten either by them or.
The Stohat Mall is typically, you know, you buy your ticket and you get a drink for your ticket, and then you get to buy whatever food you want.
Well, last year.
Portion of that goes.
Last year they had, what's his name, Danny something.
Danny Nichol.
Nichol.
Well, that's what he works at Stohat Mall.
Right, yeah, well, I think he provided the food. I don't think it was that you had, people had to pay for it.
I think for.
I think for.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah, yeah.
All right, yeah, okay. But does anybody know what they've been talking about in terms of the gala, for, the cost per ticket?
Oh, yeah, there's been a lot of discussion, and last I heard, they hadn't decided on anything, and the price range was everywhere from. I guess the top of the end was $100 a person, but that was not, when I was there, absolutely not decided upon. There was a lot of discussion about it, but that's not a definitive anything. They may have decided since, but not when the day I was there, there's just a lot of discussion about it.
Great, and that is happening on June 28th, is that correct?
Yeah.
Anybody else have other questions about the gala? And are you still able to continue going to the?
Yeah, the next one is, that's just how Patrick here wanted to be, like, I think it's like, the next one is February 27th. And we're still doing it at the same time, which was 2 to 4, at the library, probably in the smaller meeting room. There was some discussion along the lines of what you just talked about, that some people can't make that meeting because they work. And so I suggested we move it both late to be at 7, so that, I don't think you heard me say those words, so we went with what we already had. We'll work our way out of it or from there.
And, there was, a, form sent out to people on the committee, that I got, I get some of the emails about it, maybe not everything, that I had, talked to you about, because it was a form for people to fill out, to sign up and say, yes, they would do a silent auction item. And it said that the Wareham Free Library was doing this gala. Was there a conversation about?
Yes, and no, I mean, I don't think that was the exact wording, but yes, it was, Paula Gina Vale, who's the coordinator, had sent everyone all the different documents regarding the auction items and the fundraising letters and things like that. And everyone discussed them in minute detail, a lot of important edits, including the ones you were talking about, were made at that meeting. Yeah, but I haven't seen any since.
So, but it's clear that it's the Wareham Library Foundation that is doing the fundraising.
Right, yeah.
There's other.
One more?
Yes.
Sorry, I should never come to meetings. Have you thought about the foundation and the friends going to the Oyster Festival, where you get 7 million people on May 28th?
That is something that we're gonna be talking about.
I think it's great.
Yeah.
Advertising.
No, we have tabling activities through June to discuss this evening.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Okay, anything else? Okay, so, I would like to jump around a little bit to the new member recruitment application for Rich and ask Rich to just give us a few minutes if you could leave the room and we will talk about this and make our determination. Thank you. There was a little bit of a miscommunication and Rich went to a recent select board meeting where they did the interview process for him, but we're obviously not able to vote on him because we hadn't, or they weren't able to appoint him because we hadn't voted yet.
So before we go any further, we need to really clarify the process. You guys can recommend and we can totally ignore it. So we don't need your recommendation. And that's fine.
Okay.
Wendy was an exception to the three meeting rule for the right reasons, okay? But
wait, I'm sorry, what are the right reasons?
Because she has been a trustee and because she has worked for the library, she knows more than I do.
Yeah.
So the appointing authority, and I talked with Holly about it, she had been to one meeting, I think, and I said, you don't need to wait for her to go to three meetings. That's not a rule. That's a suggestion, because you don't want people coming onto boards who say, I want to be on board. That's nice. I mean, do you have any idea what you're getting into? So it's a recommendation, but it's not a hard and fast rule. And in all fairness, people have been recommended to be on certain boards and committees, and they don't get appointed, because the select people don't want to appoint them. So it's possible both ways. Just clarify.
Yeah, so in this case, Rich has not come for three meetings. He came to one meeting, and then he also came to the staff appreciation party, which we talked about making that be a second meeting. You can see from his application why he was interested in becoming a trustee and what his what he believes would be an asset to us. He's a lifelong reader, with a strong interest in supporting public libraries for all readers. He's very supportive of programs that energize the curiosity of the young, and he has a lot of time and said to me, I'm a volunteer. I'd like to volunteer. He's done some stuff at the Wareham Land Trust. I think he's just been in town a couple years. He's volunteered with the Wareham Land Trust and maybe some other groups. But he seems very enthusiastic about becoming a trustee. Does anybody have any questions or other things that they
last time
was the
people
when
he said that he would come sooner if he knew about us?
Yeah.
That's interesting too.
Yeah.
And I do think some of the free time is good because I don't unfortunately have time. So like somebody on the board who has free time.
Yes.
I can have that for you.
Yeah. Now I talked to him about some different things that we've been doing, some of the tabling events. He was very interested in that. some tabling events with just one or two of us are able to do it, so the more people that can, whose schedules permit for those kinds of things, the better. So, any other conversation, discussion? Do we have a motion
to recommend.
Okay.
Yeah.
Second. Okay. And all those in favor to recommend Rich to become a select, to become a trustee. Everybody has indicated 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in favor. Okay, all right, so we're just going here.
Should I take
it
over here?
Oh, sure. I should have mentioned too that he had already done the ethics and the code of conduct training. He's like Wareham to go. Which was great, yeah.
Did nicely in his interview with the boys and me.
Yeah.
Was it 8:00 in the morning to 6:15 or something like that? Can you do any of those?
Monday through Thursday.
Monday through Thursday. If not, I will bring you the paperwork, and you can give me your paperwork, and then you can go to the town board. Okay, I'll figure out how to get it done.
So I have it at 5:00, so I can, actually, I make it at 5:40, so I can be.
Yes, yeah, they're open until 6:15 or something.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure it's open all the time.
Yeah. They're different, one of the days is shorter, like 6:00 or something.
Okay, so Rich, happy to report that we unanimously agree that we would love to recommend you to the select board. How much are we looking forward? So when is the next select board meeting?
Tuesday.
Tuesday, and I already gave Karen that info, I think.
Yeah.
So it's on your agenda.
It's on my agenda, and you don't need to appear sometime.
Oh, maybe, okay.
Okay, so we don't need to be there.
Yeah.
Okay, all right, great. But until you actually are appointed, you cannot vote on anything. But certainly, you should feel free.
I took the two class, two or a half, did that?
Karen Wilford in the select, Karen Wilford in the select board's office.
So I can just drop them off there?
Well, no, you need to, there's a piece of paper that you need to acknowledge and give us the certificates. The open meeting law has two certificates.
I don't think it has that.
Weird. And the ethics is different. It's one certificate. And then we have you sign that you received the anti-harassment. You know, there's a whole bunch of stuff.
Okay, all right.
But, yeah, she's.
So hold off, because what you did was the code of conduct. I mean, I'm sorry, the ethics and the.
Okay.
And the open meeting law.
Yeah. No, he hasn't. Yeah. That was something that came in an email that I sent out to everybody and I included him on it or but anyway, we need to have a meeting do a little orientation and I'll make sure we get the other things that we need to and talk about and you know, get it to Karen. So maybe before we both meet, we can look at our schedules and set up.
Okay,
all right. Okay, so going backwards to Patrick.
You have the written report. The only thing that I would emphasize is a special thanks to the IT department for installing the new public computers in both the adult and children section. They've been working great. I'm not seeing negative karma on them right now.
And those are all new computers?
They're new to us.
Yeah, okay, so refurbished.
And the other bit is a thanks to, again, to municipal maintenance. Through them, the sinks are finally working and installed now, and essentially the project for the flood repairs is completed. So
how many new computers then are there into the library?
Nine.
Okay.
There are nine. Okay. There are 19-ish, all in one computer, meaning that the computer, hard drive, and monitor all in one. So there's a lot more space around the computers.
That's great.
They are all synced together, so they work through my computer now. Whereas before, my computer would turn them on, but now there are a lot of different things that you can do as far as there's an inability now with people who might be able to hack into them to hack into them. And if we were finding somebody with the ability to break through a password, I can shut down the whole system, which is kind of nice. In addition to that, they're touch screens, so it makes them more accessible. So we're always looking for ways to be more accessible. So with a touch screen, which is the swipe of the hand, you can take the font from regular size, up to much larger. So for visibility, it's greater. The screen itself is larger. It has a keyboard and a mouse cursor, of course, but you don't need to use those. So it makes it accessible on a lot of different levels. They take regular output headphones, so as long as it's the three-notch headphone input, they'll work perfectly well with that. People have adjusted to them nicely. And all the printing system, it's been able to streamline our systems a lot. A lot of the things that were on the old computers, we were allowed to remove, so that when it comes to taking it to a print shop, there are two choices versus the five choices we used to have like here. There are games installed, the ones that we found that people were asking for the most. There are certain apps that are automatically installed on it, which is fabulous, because as soon as you hit the Chrome browser, it's going to pop up the Wareham Free Library automatically. Page comes right up. Next tab is the town of Wareham, and then it has ancestry as another tab. So rather than actually having to tap on an icon to get any of those things, you're automatically taking a screenshot of the browser to the Wareham Free Library website, which means that we are constantly advertising ourselves. So that main page is up right there. So it makes access very interesting.
And all the computers are right in your domain back there?
Yeah, that's awesome. And the nice thing too is it's streamlined the amount of cord and cables that run. So, much more efficient. There's space for laptops to go there. So, yeah. It makes it much easier for classes.
Yeah.
Information learning. Nice. Very cool.
Can I just add one thing? Patrick's report.
Patrick won't brag, but I will. He was a star in the video that was produced by, I can't get the name right, but...
Tom Richardson's, yeah.
Yeah, Tom Richardson's, yeah. Explore Wareham, and it was an absolutely spectacular video. And it shows a lot of the natural resources in town. They did one 3 or 4 years ago, I think, on fishing. We now have the rights for WCTV to play that again, and the fishing one from 3 or 4 years ago too. If you didn't see it, there is Patrick and he's kayaking and he's just having the best time. And I'm like, I know that person. It was really, really must have been fun.
It was fun. It was interesting. He's a really interesting person. I totally like him on his videographer's name. But the two of them just seeing how the production was made and whatnot.
Good. And didn't he say that it's going to be on?
Yeah, they're going to play it again, and you'd have to, I don't
so remember. It's on New England Sports Network.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
SF. But also WCTV will have the ability to rebroadcast it.
If you haven't seen it, you need to, because Wareham is absolutely marvelous.
You wouldn't know.
You wouldn't know it's Wareham.
Yeah.
Share that with us?
I sent you the email on the what was given out to them.
Oh, good. Was it with your report?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the library plans 2024.
Yeah, library plans and, yeah, a few emails, usage. And
how was the reception? Like, they just sort of nodded and smiled, and that was that?
Well, I think it was good.
Good.
It was, yeah.
I will say that at the end of the finance committee all day drill, they were very complimentary of all department heads that they thought that they had brought to the table the information that they needed and then done a good on-call sales job too. So they were very complimentary.
Anything else, Patrick?
Well, I thought return on investment 605% was pretty impressive, actually. You don't get that in the bank, do you? So I think libraries providing extremely, you know, for every dollar we spend, residents get $6 in return. And when just the books that I borrow, the books that I listen to, honestly, if I had to buy them every year, I would be spending hundreds, you know. So, and never mind all the other services. So I think the libraries, you know, the museum passes, that's all really good use. I mean, that's fantastic for families, that's a huge saving. So I think we're a real great community as well.
Okay, very good. Thank you. We have a lot more to get through tonight, so I'm gonna try to keep us moving forward, and maybe we might have to cut some discussions short and continue them our next time. Let's see. So new business, summer hours. We had talked briefly at the last meeting that we were going to be discussing this. And I'm going to turn it over to Marguerite, who has been thinking and talking to people a lot about this.
Well, only because we had a resident write in that she's a part-time resident, she has a second term here, and the only time that she comes mostly is weekends, in the summer, same thing, mostly weekends. And she said over the summer she can't use the library because she arrives on, you know, Friday night late or whatever, and Saturday and Sunday the library is closed. And other people have mentioned it to me in passing, and I hadn't, in fairness, spent a lot of attention to it because, you know, you always get some comments about somebody not having something.
Can I just interject that this person, I had responded to her after a conversation with Patrick about the, you know, resources being limited for the library, and unfortunately this is, you know, what we can do right now, and directed her to lots of online things that the library could provide for her. But this is further conversation since then.
Yeah, so she basically made a fair point when she said, I'd love to go to the library on the weekend, and I've got grandkids and what have you that, you know, sometimes come and visit. And I suppose for people who live in town, especially those who work Monday to Friday, in the summer, when your kids are at home, and certainly from what I remember, what I used to do in the summer with my kids, we would go to the library on a Saturday. So it made me think. So I did a little bit of research on other libraries. So I got in touch with some of the other libraries in the area that I would say, you know, there's no such thing as the same town, but they are sort of close by and they have summer residents. You know, in the summer, their population grows with part-time people using their weekend homes or or whatever. And so, for example, Marion, they open on Saturdays from 10 to 3. Now, this is totally not, you know, bearing in mind staffing or whatever, because like I said to that particular resident, I said, look, you know, we can only staff so many hours. So we would love to have, you know, the library open 24/7. You know, all the time, but we can't start that. So we have to make choices. And, you know, at the time the choice was made to to close on Saturdays. But then I'm thinking, well, is Saturday a good day to be closed? Would Monday be a better day to be closed? And Marion, they open on Saturdays, but only until 3 o'clock, because they found that their traffic actually after 3 o'clock was pretty minimal. Mantipoiset opens Saturday from 10 to 4, but they close Mondays for the same reason. They can't start it the whole week. Bourne went through the same exercise, and they decided to close on Saturdays because they said with the bridge traffic and what have you, their attendance was the lowest in the week, and so that was the best day. However, they open Sundays, October to May. And then I asked Plymouth, which was a very much bigger library, Lakeville, I could not find an email address, but lots of money on the website, and Westport, and I haven't heard back from them. But, you know, the other libraries responded, which are very kind of them, just to sort of give a, you know. So I don't know what the feeling is, whether it is a good idea to be closed on Saturday. I mean, could we, you know, do things for kids, children's programs perhaps on Saturdays that would be great to have in the summer? Or is it, you know, is it the same as Bourne in that our attendance is the lowest and if we're going to pick a day to be closed?
Yeah, it's obviously not up to the trustees. To make this decision.
No, it isn't. But, I just thought I'd raise
to raise it and hear from you all about, you know, can it be changed, and if not, why not, what you think about, you know, the solid points that Marie has put out there, concerns that we've raised, that we've heard from other people.
I couldn't remember how many, I know we were closed on Saturdays this last summer. Was that the first summer or was the one before as well?
You haven't been, when I came here in 2021, you were only open Monday through Friday, 9 to 5.
Right.
And I think the summer before
was open.
No, I'm not talking about that. The summer before last.
When the past two summers, we've been closed.
Could I finish? Yes, we closed on the weekend. And I would like to finish what I was trying to say. We changed some of the hours here so that spinning was open some of the time in the summer. That happened not last summer, but the summer before. Anybody have any thoughts about this?
Yeah, I mean, was the decision taken for Saturday to close, was it because those were the lowest
Saturday
numbers?
Is our lowest day of the week all year for usage. The Board of Library Commissioners requires us to be open 6 days a week, however they do allow communities to give a break technically between Memorial Day and Labor Day. Saturdays, July and August, the Children's Library remind us for that, plus it does keep us open for the school year on Saturdays as well. So truly just a matter of staffing and putting our resources in the best place that we can. And trying to provide the most services that we can with what we have.
Yeah, no, and there are really good points, you know, and there's only so much money to go around. So I absolutely accept that. It's just, I find it a shame that, you know, people who come here pay taxes, you know, and have a second home, and can't use the library.
I'm sorry, you said they can't use the library, they can't?
Well, they could use the online version, but they can't physically come in.
They're just coming on the weekends.
And they go, if they just come from the weekends, which is predominantly what people do. And some people may come like the whole summer, so they could use the library during the week. But a lot of people just come weekends for temporary residents. So then you arrive Friday night, Saturday, like the first Sunday, like the first lunch, you know, Monday, Friday.
And we don't really know what the impact would be from those people. You know, the town doubles in size, as we all know, in the summertime. How many of those people are coming just on the weekends? I don't really know. But if the library were open for some part of the time on a Saturday, would some of those people be using it? So that it would be a higher usage than what we see other times of the year. I don't know how we would measure that.
Let me jump in here and tell you that you're sort of crossing the borderline in terms of staffing issues are related to union contracts, which are negotiated over a period of time, usually good for 3 years. There also is the financial ramification of any suggestion, and I would say that there makes me stand on a street corner and sell pencils to get a dime out of him. But because of him, and because of his ability to run the finances of this town, we just got re-rated at AA+ for our bond rating. And that is spectacular because it saves us a huge amount of money. And the only reason we are not a AAA is because our citizens do not have the ability to pay more. So I got to hand it to any department head, chair, whatever you want to call him or her. You know, they have to squeak to get money out of there, and it is a true balancing act. And there is not a department in this town, with one exception, that is not understaffed. And the exception is not the one we're sitting
in. No, I think that we are all very clear that this is not ours to make, and that there are all these other issues, but it is part of our role to provide feedback that we get from people in the town about what's happening at the library. That's what I think this is about.
I don't have an agenda. I'm just feeling through it, and I thought, well, it's an interesting, you know, because I get it. People who are here part time might be able to use the library. At the same time, we only have so much money, and it makes sense to put your resources on the busiest days. So,
it's a good exercise. And it's a good exercise to know what other towns and around us are doing.
Well, and they too have staffing issues.
Yeah. Okay.
And Marky, that might be an interesting direction for us to think about when we talk about our tabling events. And I didn't know what tabling event was until like a couple weeks ago, which means, so I want to explain for other people like me, is I mean, the trustees, as part of their role of supporting the library, we want to get the word out about the library, that it exists, and all of the things it offers. And so we try to get a table at a town event, and we staff a table, or our supporters, friends, relatives staff those tables, to make sure that we're doing community outreach, so that the people who live in this town, who come to this town, understand who we are, where we are, and what we do. So I think that this conversation is a nice spark to get our attention, you know, in the coming warmer months and the discussions we're going to have tonight. How can we include that population? So how we can serve them the way we serve, you know, we serve the rest of the populations of this community, or those intermittent and summer residents should be served as well. And how can we do that, and how can we let them know what we're doing?
Well, it's actually happening Tuesday, is black. To reach out to summer residents. And I personally have gone to, you know, on vacation and what have you, and I've used the libraries elsewhere. And I'd be very grateful to have them there. So, but I realise it's a complicated.
If I may project something, just from an outside point of view, as a person who would come to the library on Saturdays, because that's when it fit my schedule better, it was dead zone in here. Really, really quiet. And I felt like, I mean, I'd get here, I would stay an hour or so, and there'd be nobody here, and it always felt like a waste of resources. And if I could have found another day of the week, I would have come there instead, if I, you know, that those hours could apply, being able to serve a greater population. But the research that we've done, I think, could be made into something so that when you're having conversations with your summer residents, that you might want to put a spin on it and say, no, our library is not open on weekends during the summertime. However, with your sales library card, here are branch libraries in the area. These are the hours that are open. Here are directions, here's a map, whatever the case may be, to direct them to the ones that may be closest to them, and then highlight some of the things that might be going on with them. In addition to, you brought up a great point, of directing them towards the electronic resources, because that's one of the best things that the library card offers them. And the electronic resources aren't just things like ebooks, audiobooks, streaming TV, movies, and things like that, but by going on the library website, you also have access to databases. So if someone comes down and has to work on a report that weekend, or needs resources, all of our mobile in-house reference resources are available online. So they can click on those resources and get them whether or not the library are, but is open, which is a huge benefit.
Oh, that's a, I think that's a good point, and that's something that we can be looking at when we're looking at what we are going to be doing for tabling events the rest of this year. Okay, anything else about that before we move on? Okay, all right. So the staff appreciation event follow-up, the only thing that I just wanted to just let people know is that I did send a thank you note to, to the manager, the general manager at Town Tavern. I sent it to the general manager because she personally donated food to them. Appreciation event. I don't know if people were around for all of that, but there was a lot of food left over. Some of the staff took, or it was here. Some people took stuff home. And the stuff that we got from Town Tavern and Tap was like a big foil thing filled with all kinds of veggies and two big quarts of dip. There was a lot of that left, unfortunately. But thank you to Nancy and to Sarah, who took it to the Kendrick House. And I'm sure there was goodies made of it. But thank you to everybody who helped to pull that together.
Yeah.
So it was, as Judith said, I think it was
And the food was beyond.
There was plenty of that for sure, and I do hope that the staff appreciated it and enjoyed it. Not just appreciated, but enjoyed it is really what I hope they did. I think you did, because you came in saying, I'm only staying for 10 minutes. 45 minutes later, so
well,
I'm still here.
I went and I told my meeting, I'll be back.
So that's good. Okay. All right, and then the gala update we already talked about. In terms of number three, increasing community outreach to community organizations, I was going to talk about the Oyster Festival that's coming up. That's the only thing that I know of that is coming up where we might, well, we helped at the duck race last time, but we didn't really have our own separate table there. But that's the only thing that I know of right now that is coming up.
Can I talk briefly about that?
About?
The duck race?
Sure, one second. The Oyster Festival, we didn't do it last year because it's put together by a private organization and it was going to cost us $100 or something. And, sorry?
$50.
$50, okay.
Yeah.
Which obviously we don't have. Now, the Harvest Moon Festival was also going to cost us, and we asked the Hudson Bay Association to waive that fee for us, and they happily did. And I think we could try to do that with the Oyster Fest people as well, and hopefully we would, you know, get the...
Well, I think it's different for vendors, you know. For vendors, they're actually there to make money, and they expect to pay for their table.
Sure.
I think for a non-profit, like the library, I would have thought they'd either have, you know, they'd let us have it for free or very, very minimal amount.
Well, Bertie told me that they would waive the fee.
Okay, all right. Okay. And did that little birdie tell you who that we need to talk to about the Oyster Festival? Is that Nora?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Perhaps as the face of our outreach, you could take that on and I can talk to you about who you need to contact. But,
I can organize it. I can't be as if I can. But I'm happy to.
Yeah, so it's a few months away, but people are starting to make plans.
What's the date again?
May 28th. There's no rain date, and they already have more than half the number of people signed up than they did for the whole year.
Right. It's Memorial Day weekend.
Yeah.
Yes, Memorial Day weekend.
Yeah, it's a very popular event. Mm-hmm. And we reach a lot of people there. I'm expecting that I'll be around because I'm actually going to be away the last 2 weeks of June and not able to be here for the gala. So I expect that I would be able to help with that.
Let me just double check that day too.
Okay.
Either as a trustee or a friend, whatever happens.
Okay. And Deanne is still interested in helping with these kinds of things too.
Oh, okay.
So, but nobody has to commit to it right now, if you could just keep it in mind on that date. And then we'll figure it out. Does anybody
have you ever attended the Oyster Festival? Have you attended the Oyster Festival? Are you here in town? No. It's fun.
Yeah, you really should. It is a lot of fun.
Yeah.
I usually hide in my house because there's too many people.
Yeah, it's not great for me. I'm not big on events like that, but.
But when you table, it's different.
Yeah.
It was between 5,000 and 8,000 people come to it.
Yeah,
no, it's huge.
Yeah.
It's very well attended. Yeah. It's very, very popular. And me, I hate horses. Understandable. But there's lots of other stuff there too.
Yeah, lots of vendors and books and crafts stuff. Okay, so you wanted to say something about the duck race?
Yeah, maybe that's something that Nancy and I as friends can talk about. Like at the duck race, I know it's not a fundraiser, but the Imagination Library could be promoted. Maybe it's Priscilla's event, so I don't want to make more work for everybody because I know when the thought goes into that. But I was just wondering how fruitful or fruitless it would be to be a little bit more.
There's
informational.
A lot that goes on at that registration and picking the ducks and everything. I don't know that there is room for other things
So I just sort of wanted to air my thoughts on it because I was there last year and I helped for three, 4 months. I don't know.
Yeah.
And it's a great event.
Yeah, but people I think were more interested in the ducks and the games while they were waiting.
Yeah.
I'm not sure that they would be that interested in
other stuff. Yeah, that'd be distracting. Yeah.
Are there other events that people know about that are coming up? Please pay attention over the next month and go to the next meeting.
Well, I mean, how the last year, we did the Oyster Festival, we did the...
Did the Oyster Festival?
No.
No, were we going to?
No, because we, you know, didn't ask to have the registration fee waived.
Can we do something in June?
It's Wareham.
Well, we helped with the dump race.
Yeah, I helped with the dump race.
Oh, there was something in the town hall, yeah.
Oh, and, yeah, what was that?
The showcase, was that a showcase?
I'm looking at the town.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that happening again this year?
Probably not, but there will be a sip and stroll, probably, by Warner Brunel, who is Danny Warner's daughter, and she does them in Minnesota. And they're extremely...
Oh, very popular.
Yeah, very popular.
Downtown?
Yes, and we're working on cleaning up trash barrels. Because she wants to have it along the riverfront, which is, you know, absolutely...
And is that for more than one time?
It would be one day, but it would be an annual event. She has an annual in Minnesota.
Yeah, I know.
Have you been there? Yeah.
Yeah, cool.
And that's...
That's what I think we would need. We'd probably request a table or something.
Why not?
Yeah, think about it.
Because it's artists and vendors. She puts it together. Morgan puts it together. She does the whole thing. She gets all the permits, she gets the vendors, she gets everything. I haven't been to one, but I've heard from three different...
Yeah, no, I've been to...
Yeah, it's all over the world, yeah.
Right.
You could also just wear your own hats and sit and stroll.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, as far as events coming up, we have a series of book sales coming up. We have a lot of people coming in and out of the library and want to support it. There's someone from the trustees who are here during book sales. Wouldn't they just say hi and talk about what we do, or just have information available? I mean, I brought out flyers and stuff to book sales, but I'm busy then running around with book sales stuff. But it would be an opportunity for trustees to be visible at least during that information.
Oh, yeah, that's a great idea, actually.
And there's the next one coming up, is it going to be in March?
March 20th to 23rd. Priscilla emailed us all the dates for the whole year, which I'm going to share with you.
Yeah, that would be great. Is that something that you feel like we can talk about at the next meeting and pull together if we're going to do something? The next meeting will be, I think, the 14th of March. Because it's about a week.
Yeah, well, no.
Figure it out.
Well, even if we don't do it for the March meeting, we can find something.
Okay. All right. The Peep Diorama Contest. What's going on with that?
Oh, please do it again. Please do it again.
Oh, yeah.
So wonderful.
Well, the reason we want to know about it is because we missed the boat last year, and none of us feel particularly real creative about it. Oh, you are? Excellent.
Oh, yay.
Because maybe then we can coordinate that, the trustees' participation in that. But we felt like we needed a lot of lead time to make that happen.
My participation is on by the peeps. I am not artsy.
So
do
we have dates for it?
It'll be March. March. Yeah, I think.
Easter's the 31st.
Easter's the 31st, so usually they have to be in the week or two before Easter. I have to look at the calendar, but March. Usually they dropped off a week before Easter so that they're here on display.
Okay.
When's Easter?
March 31st. It's early this year.
I'm confused. Why? They're only here a week?
They're here like 2 weeks, the week before they're setting up, but the judging is for a week.
So
Oh, okay, yeah, that's very right. We have to,
So Wendy, can you, are you thinking about that? Because I think it's something that we'll probably have to be pulling together before our next meeting, the next meeting is the 14th.
I was like, can you maybe pull it, so kind of like, email everybody with your ideas, and all of us have a brainstorming session?
I mean, you can work on the diagrams now, with a different word out, but you could start working on it now.
Yeah, our topic is we live the ideas.
Right.
We live our ideas.
Right, that's not our strong suit, but Wendy, Captain, you. So perhaps you could put some ideas, or some thoughts, I think some ideas, and send them out to us.
No one's done the duck race, no one's done the Oyster Fest.
They did the flood, and that was great.
They did the flood.
That really was one of the.
Wasn't it? It was just so great.
That means I got the race last year, but not as a trustee. I don't know if this is trustee material, but we can do a book sale, a friend's book sale, do a little mini. Crystal Porter, a little mini. And a little mini.
Yes.
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 Then we can auction it off.
All right, so,
That's a great.
All right, we've got about 10 minutes, unless we want to go beyond 7 o'clock. And I don't think anybody, wants to, so I'm gonna jump to the three policies that I have listed on here. The patron behavior policy, the meeting room policy, and the materials collection policy. We have talked for the last year and a half about how the trustees are supposed to be signing off on reviewing any updates, changes to the policies on a yearly basis per the MBLC. That's what they say, that they suggest that the policies get reviewed every year. We have not really reviewed any of them. And there are policies that are on our website that don't have dates on them for when they were reviewed last. And so what I am suggesting is that, and the patron behavior policy came up at the last meeting when we talked about the sign about people's behavior that has been put out in the front, because there was wording on there that was different from what the behavior policy says. So I would like to suggest that these three policies are ones that we ask Patrick to bring to us one a month for the next 3 months, or before, so that we can vote on these before the end of June, for you to, take a look at them, make any suggested changes, maybe start in April, May, and June, maybe have to start in March, so that we can make sure that we, can review these. So that's my suggestion.
I was just going to make note of the fact that this board is a policy setting board, which means that you are to rely upon the director to bring you policies when they are actually making the revisions to those policies based upon a strategic plan. So when the director has the ability to bring a policy to the board, at that point it is up for your consideration to look at that policy, to suggest revisions, to consider it, and then based upon your suggestions, if the director feels that something that the policy would benefit from, those changes and revisions would be made, and then you as the board set it in place. That's what setting policies in place is. It isn't the writing of the policy,
not
it's the revision of the policy, but it's when the director has an opportunity to actually work on a policy, then they bring it to you. Just so you know, Patrick is working on policies right now, but I am not going to be rushed. FYI, my time is limited. I'm working in my class right now on an updated materials collection development policy, because we have two in this building. We have one for the whole collection, and then we have one for the stone room collection. I spent all of the last policy was updated in 2019. Typically, you have anywhere between a 5 and 10 year gap when you actually write policies, because I'm in a class right now where we're talking about collection development policies, and we write the policies for libraries. And most libraries may take a look at the policies on an annual basis, meaning a director will look them over, but they don't get revised on an annual basis. They don't get re-stamped or set back into action on an annual basis. They only get revised if something comes up that shows that there's a need to change it. So there are things in our collection development policy that do need changing.
I mean, just stop with it. I'm not suggesting that we ask for them to be revised. For instance, the meeting room policy that you said was last revised in 2019 or approved by this board.
That's
in 2019.
The CDP, not the meeting room. I was talking about the first policy. Okay. That was done in 2019.
Okay. So I understand what you're saying about the two different policies. But for instance, the meeting room policy, I have it right here. There's like no date on it for when it was reviewed. And I think it should have something on there. And Patrick is going to look at it and bring it to us and say, this is good. I don't suggest anything different. We look at it. If we agree to it, we just approve it. And it gets put onto the website saying that it has been approved as of, you know, whatever date this year. But I do think that we have to get this stuff in, you know, we have to be seeing it, at least reviewing most of them on a regular basis. And there doesn't seem to be any regular basis that is happening. And the MBLC does suggest that it is reviewed on a yearly basis. So that says to me that they should be brought to us. You know, that Patrick says, okay, I reviewed this this year and it's fine. That's what I think is fine. What do you all think? And we can then make a determination about it. The patron behavior policy has specific information in it about what happens if a patron is found in violation of any of those policies. This really came to the forefront of my mind when we started talking about the sandwich board that gets posted out there with different things that people are not allowed to do at the library. And the last line says, if you violate any of this, you'll be ejected or, you know, removed from the library or whatever. That is not the same as what the patron behavior policy says.
That says you get a warning, right? That's what the sign is, a warning.
That's not what the sign said. It says you'll be asked to leave the library. This says you'll be asked to cease engaging in said behavior as the first
was,
step.
As I mentioned before, that was a recommendation and advised to me by the police chief.
I understand.
To help solve the issue, so that's what it is there for. So
I understand
there's no
that.
Bidding, there's no. And I get what you're saying, Molly, but that's, you're looking at, it's an attempt to solve the problem that we're facing on a daily basis. And that is, as Mel said, as the police chief did tell me, it is the warning. You write the sign coming in, so don't do this, or you will be asked to leave. That was your warning.
I don't think that just because the police chief said it, I don't think that means that it complies with what we have written here. The other piece is that there's no date on this as well, so I don't know when this has been reviewed last. That is really more the concern, is that if we are a policy-setting board, then we need to know when these policies have been set, and they need to be reviewed on a regular basis.
Well, I can look up the dates for you. Most of them were done during Michael's term as director, which is 2015 to 2019.
Okay, so that's too long ago as far as I'm concerned. And that's why I
would be happy to bring policies to you as I need it.
Well, what I am suggesting that the trustees ask for is that these three policies or maybe not the collection based on what Val has said, but the meeting room policy and the patron behavior policy be reviewed and brought to us so that we can make a determination about this year.
I do my best to get the policies to you as I can. There have been a lot of things that have come up that have caused things that I should be doing, taking a backseat.
Can I offer an alternative? Since as of right now, what it's sounding like is that your time is being taken up by a lot of things. You're looking for something to do as a board.
No.
You're trying to create a system. You're trying to put something in place that...
We're trying to do what we're supposed to be doing.
No, that's what I'm saying. You're trying to create a system to kind of streamline things. In the meantime, until you actually get handed those policies, what if those policies that you see right in front of you get brought to the board as they are right now, you approve them as they are right now, you put a date on them as they are right now, and then over the course of the next year, you have the opportunity to work with Patrick, support Patrick as he's writing the policies, and then when they come through, then you can redate them. It's a matter of dates.
We have offered to work with Patrick on this before, mm-hmm. this. We have talked about this several times.
A strategic plan needs to be done for a policy meeting.
You talked about the long term.
Yes.
Well, what do people think about that suggestion?
I think it makes sense. We not really have something that's complicated, but it also gives us plenty of time to work for it, and by next fiscal year, we'll have the revised as needed.
So you're talking about the meeting room use and the patron behavior policy?
Those are the ones on your list, right?
Right, that's what I'm
The ones that you're worried about that don't have dates, I'm just suggesting that you look at them now. I mean, they all have been and always will be on the website. So anything that you see there that you feel that needs to have a date on it as of right now, that you go ahead, you accept them as they are right now, with the idea that over the course of the next year, you will have an opportunity as things are brought to you for your approval to make your suggestions. Under further consideration, be able to take the time with them.
I guess I'm a little confused as to what good it would do. Like, for me tonight to vote on that policy.
Well, we wouldn't be voting.
No, we wouldn't. Not tonight.
So, what are you proposing? What is the proposal before us?
No, I was just a suggestion to say that you look at the policies as they are right now. If it's a matter of just date stamping something, more than anything else, it's a matter of date, so that you can get something on an annual calendar.
I don't know that it is just a matter of date, because I don't think that we all have reviewed them. If we review it and decide that the meeting room policy, for example, is fine the way it is, that we can put that date on it, and then it would be next year.
Now that's what I'm confused too, because the policies are typically brought to you from the library director. The library director brings the policy to you based upon their knowledge of library policy in compliance with MBLC's rules and what is normal practices. So if you as a board choose to look at a policy that the director's brought you and to tear it completely apart from the person who actually has the most experience in writing those types of policies, you're not really supporting the library director. Does that make sense? Your goal is to actually look at it and make sure that the wording is in line with what it's supposed to be, and then you formally accept it. You're not really there to revise and write it. The only thing you really revise and write are your own bylaws.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. But I think the point Holly is making is that we have a whole load of policies that have never been or haven't been reviewed for the longest time, and we don't really know when because there are no dates.
Right.
So I think what Holly is saying is we'd like to make a start, because supposedly that is our role and we should be doing that on a yearly basis. So we picked some policies that we thought were easy, you know, easy stuff, and also the patron behavior policy, bearing in mind that the issues that have been here.
I wish you'd been there this afternoon, if the board could do one thing, is come in every single afternoon and just run her own kids for me, that would be fantastic. Without that sign, it's going to be miserable. Absolutely. We had a kid, we had to call the police today, there's a child outside, hit in the face with a chunk of ice, because a whole group thought it would be fine.
Well, we were not suggesting that that sign totally go away. We were suggesting that it be a different kind of sign, one that looked less scrawled, for one thing, because it looked like a really unprofessional kind of sign, and one that also was written in a way that reflected the patron behavior policy.
I guess I need some clarification. You said the sign is not there.
No, the sign is not.
And that there was a cause that was a helpful thing when it was there.
Absolutely.
And now it's not there.
And now it's not there.
Why isn't it there now?
We took it down.
We took it down because.
Why would we take it down? Maybe what?
Just to see.
Because Holly mentioned that it was.
Wait, I'm getting two different answers here. Sorry, but I am. Why was it taken down?
I had it taken down after the last meeting to see what, how it would be, knowing it was raising the controversy.
Okay, so that's a month ago.
And we've noticed the kids have been a little more freer this month.
So would you like to put it back up?
So we are going to get that.
Then that is what I hope would happen, if you think it should go up. I think it should go up. I don't think this is necessarily, I'm not speaking for the board, I'm speaking as a person.
We just took down after the discussion last meeting and thought, let's see what it looks like, basically.
So you can't really see this very well, but this is an example of a different kind of a sign. It says the same kind of things. I think that if we want to have a sign like that, then we should spend a little bit of money and make it a nice looking sign, instead of just a scrawled thing that says, don't do this, don't do that. This sign is from South Shore Health. Starts out by saying, our facility is a healing environment for our patients. And then in big letters and in bright red, it says, aggressive behavior will not be tolerated. And then it gives some examples of aggressive behavior. Thank you for your cooperation. Now, that's just one example. I think there are different ways to get that message out there that isn't that the sign that we have, and that is not following what this policy says. So we're having two different conversations here, one about the patron behavior policy and the sign, and then also just what we want to do about the policies generally. So maybe we need to table all of it until the next meeting, after we have some more time to look at this stuff and think about it.
For example, the sign could say something like, the library is here for everyone, for all residents, right? Or for the Wareham community. In order for that to be so, please, respect the following, or whatever you want to put.
It was just okay. As the secretary pro tem, and point out that we're now past 7 p.m. Yeah. Yeah. And I personally, as a person, feel that we're getting way too in the weeds about this stuff. I have no idea what we're talking about right this moment. I do not know. I don't know if we're talking about policy, I don't know if we're talking about sign, that in my humble opinion should go up immediately. If it had that kind of an effect on the people and staff of our library, I have no idea what I'm supposed to write down about this discussion right now.
Well, that's why I said it sounds like we're having two different conversations here.
At least two.
And so I would like to go back to Mel's suggestion about at least the meeting room policy. I would also add that in the bylaws, it says the board is responsible for setting policy for the library, adding and revising policies and practices to ensure that the library is in compliance with its strategic plan, the town law, with the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners, the library certification body. That, to me, is not just double stamping whatever Patrick, who, yes, is much more experienced in writing policies, but it is not just rubber stamping that. It is reviewing it and saying, this doesn't make any sense, or why are we not talking about this? It does mean revising or adding things to it, not just saying, oh, okay, you think it's fine, okay. And so I think it takes longer to do that than just us saying, okay, let's put the date on.
Well, that was why I agree with that, which is why I'm saying giving until June is not sufficient time. However, if you're concerned with some dates, to go ahead and rubber stamp them with the dates with the opportunity for you to take a look at what the current policies are online.
I guess I don't understand why if we take the collection policy out and just look at the meeting room and the patron behavior policy, there's not enough time for us, for Patrick to do that between now and the end of June, given that it hasn't been done at all. So I don't understand that.
So say that I will bring forward what I can. I hope to be able to bring that forward to you. This past year, a lot of things have come up that did not give over a long time. You had the long range plan to much longer than I anticipated. Policy takes time. I'm not going to just rush through a policy just for the sake of a policy. And they do take time to review and evaluate. So I would be happy to bring forward a policy when I'm able to, and hopefully I will be able to get these through by the end of the year. That's all I'm saying.
I do have a point of order, in a way, I guess. Because we did not vote on the long-range plan last month, that means that according to policy or past practice, whatever, Patrick can't send back to Mr. Foss.
Correct.
So are we able or willing to vote on the long-range plan right now? So that Patrick can or can't take his plan to the town administrator? Where do we stand with that?
Well, we have not gotten to that part of the agenda. I have reviewed it more and have more that I would want to discuss about it before I could vote. But maybe other people are at a point where they feel like they want to just vote. If somebody wants to do that, they can make a motion. But I would like there to be more discussion. And we could make that be the main discussion at the next meeting, do that first in the meeting.
If we could discuss this the next meeting, which I think is a good idea, any suggestion or question or something could become a policy. We have book sales on Friday sometimes. When we're here, but the library is closed. And we've had hundreds of kids who want to come in and congregate in the bathrooms and droves. And we have to take ourselves away from the book sale to get them out of there. And so, I wonder if there could be some kind of policy saying that if the library's closed, the bathrooms are closed. Could we just say that to eliminate how the kids come in here in packs and want to?
Well, that was only, when we were open to Spinney, that those Thursdays when we're closed here, chances are that it's not going to occur.
So should we table this for next time? I mean, would that?
Well, I guess, like I argued on the side of this argument last meeting, I'd like to make a move that we vote to approve the long-range plan so that we can do our jobs as library trustees and that Patrick can do his job as the library director and move this along the process of part of the long range plan this library. So I move that we vote to approve. Do I get a second?
Is there a second?
I'll second then.
Okay.
Okay. Everybody then
in favor?
In favor of approving the long range plan? Raise your hand. Three? And opposed? Two. Okay. So the long range plan has been approved. 3-2.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Any public comment that we have not already heard? Okay.
everybody before we adjourn? Do I have a motion to adjourn?
What time is it?
It is 7:11.
Move to adjourn at 7:11.
Sarah, second by Wendy, all in favor? Everybody in favor? Okay, and adjourn at 7:11.